Welcome to StarWest Virtual. We're excited that you're joining us today. Over the course of the next 2 days, we have 13 great presentations lined up for you. All these presentations are brought to you live from StarWest 2015 in Anaheim, California. First, let me tell you how to navigate through the conference. The top navigation bar will take you to each room within the conference, including the Expo, Networking Lounge, and Presentation Center. In the Expo, visit top testing providers to learn the latest in testing solutions. Be sure to chat with a sponsor representative to get all the details you need. Take a moment to chat with others in your industry in the Networking Lounge. There are group chats, discussion boards, and more. Be sure to take our survey and let us know what you think of the conference. Your feedback will help us improve your experience. You will also see the Grand Prize Center and Trivia tabs on the top navigation. Visit the Prize Center to learn about earning points to win one of three $100 Amazon gift cards. Visit the Trivia tab to play our StarWest trivia game. Currently, you're in the Presentation Center. All the live presentations will broadcast from here. You will see three tabs in the Presentation Center: Wednesday, Thursday, and Interviews. Please check each tab of presentation listings each day, and check out our live interviews with conference speakers. Interviews will be streamed periodically throughout the day between presentations. If you need any help at any time, please visit the Tools tab and click on Help Desk. We're available to help troubleshoot any technical difficulties you may have. We hope you have a great experience at StarWest Virtual.
Good morning, this is StarWest. We're excited to see so many people here. Just glad to have you all. My name is Lee Copeland. I'm the program chair of the conference. And it's my official duty to welcome you and to give you some important announcements that I think will kind of smooth your conference visit. First of all, I want to acknowledge our sponsors for the conference. Our sponsors donate all kinds of things like time and money and help make the conference. And I would invite you to visit with them in the expo. Do me a favor, would you express your appreciation to them for their sponsorship? This is a list of our platinum sponsors, of which there are a number this time. Our gold sponsors. And our partners. And each of these contributes in their own way to the success of the conference. Now, we have people here from all over the world. If you're from outside the United States, would you stand and let us acknowledge you? If you're from outside the U.S., welcome. We're glad to have you here. This is, I think, a complete list of the countries, but if I've left your country off, I apologize. And yeah, we have Utah down at the bottom. Where's the Utah group? Oh, yeah, all right. Over there, a lot of them. You know, I'm from Utah, so I get to tease a little bit. It's a whole nother country. There's a sign at the border, if you've never been to Utah, it says, "Welcome to Utah, set your watch back 100 years." So we welcome those of you who are from outside the U.S. and hope that you enjoy your trip to our country. Oh, sorry. Okay, you have received in your packet a brochure that tells you about the conference and all the sessions that are associated with it. It also has a map in it, and this is kind of your guide to today and tomorrow. So take that out, take a look at that, and use that. Already we have a change of sessions. We got a note from a speaker yesterday who has become very ill, simply can't join us. The session is W11 today. It's on continuous delivery. Late last night, Jeff Payne of Caveros volunteered to present a session in that time slot. Jeff and his people at Caveros are marvelous supporters of our conference. We appreciate him just stepping in at the last minute. So if you had planned on going to W11, It'll still be there. It'll be on continuous delivery. It'll just have a different speaker today. I want to call that to your attention. Okay, presenter one-on-ones. We have what I think is a great opportunity for you as delegates to chat with a testing expert. You can sign up for a 15-minute block of time. You can do that. It's held right out here in the center lounge. And the sign-up board's near the registration desk. You can just go sign up for 15 minutes of various folks. And here are the presenters who are going to be sitting at tables waiting for you today. Now, all of this information, you don't have to take pictures or copy this all down. You have a little blue note on or by your chair that has all this same information on it. So you'll have that handy. You don't have to remember stuff or write stuff down. But these folks have graciously volunteered their time to chat with you. And just, you know, go up and sign up for a slot and go chat with them and bring them a problem, bring them questions, bring them, you know, just chat. Do whatever you like. It's your 15-minute block. So we appreciate those speakers who have volunteered their time. We're going to do this again tomorrow. Today we also have a Meet the Speakers lunch. You can actually eat with a testing expert. And these are the folks that are going to be there. That we're going to have a name tag on each table. Just go and sit and chat and, again, bring your questions or comments or just get to know people. These are all nice folks, and they'd be happy to talk with you. So join them for the Meet the Speakers lunch. Again, we're going to do that again tomorrow, so you'll have time. The Testing Expo opens this morning at 10:30. We have lots of vendors who've come to show their wares and talk about their tools and services. Would encourage you to go by and visit with them. The hours today, 10:30 to 2, they close from 2 to 3:30, just to kind of have a rest, and then they're open again from 3:30 to 6:30. I want to call your attention to the reception tonight. I'll mention it two or three times today, but it goes from 5:30 to 6:30, and it's in the expo area. Tomorrow, the vendors will be back. But they close early tomorrow. Expo closes at 3. So don't wait till the end of the day tomorrow to go visit them. You know, do that today or before 3 tomorrow. All right, when you go around the expo, you can play the passport game. When you enter, we'll give you a little card. You take it to the various vendors. You have them stamp or click. And then you, and that starts at 10:30 today. You put those passports, after you have enough stamps, into the TechWell booth. There's a big raffle box there. They need to go in the booth, in the bucket by 5:45, because at 6 o'clock tonight, we will have a drawing. We will choose some of those. We will award prizes, the valuable prizes, worth up to dollars. But you must be present to win. If we call your name and you're not there, you don't get the prize. The way it is. So you want to be there at 6 tonight and win valuable prizes. Okay, the bookstore, Breakpoint Books, is back here again with us for the 10th consecutive year. They bring a big pile of the best testing books. This is just, you know, one example of the many excellent books available here. Sorry. It's in my contract. I have to do it. But drop by, browse, take a look at the books, buy some if you find something that's interesting to you. They're open both today and tomorrow. So we welcome and appreciate the Breakpoint Books folks. Also in the center lounge, ThinkSys folks have sponsored Wi-Fi spot for us. This is the ID and password. So if you're looking for Wi-Fi, good, solid, reliable Wi-Fi. You'll find it out in the lounge. There is a mobile app that you can get for your phone. If you haven't already heard about this, just search for StarWest 2015 at the App Store. And it lists all the sessions, all the speaker bios, just everything you need. It's a great little application. So I encourage you to download that and use that if that's something of interest to you. Mindtree has sponsored this. We appreciate them doing that. If you're a Twitter person, Now, I'm old, you know, and I don't really understand this social media stuff. But hashtag StarWest. The other day, one of my kids said, Grandpa, what's the password for the Wi-Fi? And I told him it was # something. They had no idea what a pound sign was. I said, it's that thing. They said, oh, hashtag. No, you know, Beethoven was one of the earliest users of that, right? Okay. He liked them a lot. So if you're on Twitter, hashtag StarWest is a good place. On Friday, we have the Leadership and Quality Summit. If you haven't already registered, it's not too late. There's an additional charge for that full day. It's $500. You can sign up at the registration desk. If you're already signed up, great. You're going to have a marvelous time at the Leadership Summit on Friday. Okay, also, some other things I want to call your attention to. Either underneath you or next on the seat next to you, there's some little green forms. We call them the green forms, but they're actually session evaluation forms. If you would take a moment and evaluate each of the sessions that you attend, both keynotes and concurrent sessions, just take a minute, put the name of the presenter or the title of the session, and then a numeric score. What's most useful, though, is if you'll turn it over and write on the back, write some comments, what you liked, what you thought the speaker could improve on, what you'd like to hear more about or less about. These sessions, I think I'm being attacked by zombies in white coats here. These forms actually finally go back to the speakers, and they get your feedback directly. So that's a way that you can influence them in the future. Also, tomorrow we're going to hand out evaluation forms for the entire conference. And if you would take a few minutes to fill that out, we would appreciate your feedback. Again, we pay close attention to these and find these very useful. Many of the things that we do in this conference did not come from our great thinking. It came from feedback from delegates like you. So we would encourage you to do that. Plus, to kind of give you an incentive, we're going to offer valuable prizes. We'll pick two or three out of the hat and give you some prizes just for filling that in. So appreciate that. All right. You guys must be here for this, right? All right. This is Bart and Wade. They're going to talk about the test lab, which is a really cool thing that happens right out here. And so let me give a couple minutes to them.
Thank you, Lee. Well, like Lee already said, I'm Bart.
I'm Wade. Hello.
And we are running the test lab. And the test lab basically is a place to test at the testing conference. How cool is that? So we've got puzzles and stuff like that. How do I click to the next? Can you click, Lee, or do I have to click? Thank you. So the test lab is basically your tester sandbox. We've got robots. We've got games. We've got puzzles. We've got systems under test. We've got a humanitarian toolbox, which we would like you to test to see if you can find errors and or feedback for that. We want you to come in with people, with your colleagues, and do peer testing, to do pairwise testing, because then you can learn from each other. There's prizes to be won. I'm not sure what the prizes are, but they're really good. So I really enjoy if you all come in and win the prizes, because those will be good. Anything goes. If you have a question, then we see if we can answer it. So we'll be open today and tomorrow, all during conference hours. And then, next slide, please. We also have some games to be played. I've written down a number of games, and you need a number of people to play them. So if you gather the group, we will facilitate the game. These will be testing games, more or less. Some of them will be a bit off-testing, but near-testing, and some of them will be spot-on testing games. So if you gather the crowd, come to the test lab, we will play the game and hope that you will learn stuff. So the main idea about test lab is it's going to be fun, it's going to be about testing, and it's going to be learning by doing instead of by listening. So I hope to see you all in the test lab, but not all at once, I hope. Anything to add, Wade?
Sounds good. We'll see you there.
Good. See you there.
All right. Allison? I want to introduce you to Allison Wade, who's going to tell you about a fantastic idea that we're going to do on Friday for the first time. Please.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. We are going to have a day on Friday dedicated to women in software testing. And this is a day not only to talk about software testing, but also for women to talk about their careers and the things that really matter to them. We have a fantastic lineup. Some of the people are going to be talking about how they use software techniques and methodologies to enhance their life and make changes in their life and their personal careers. Jamie Newberry is going to be talking about, she's a software designer, and she's going to be talking about how she used software design principles to redesign her life at a time when she really needed to do that. Lauren and Tanya Kattar are going to be talking about a program that they've started for young women in technology, and it's about, it's called It Was Never the Dress. It's a fantastic campaign. And they're going to be talking about how they used agile methodologies to start that company and that campaign, and it's just fantastic stuff. Melissa is going to be talking about when you're the only tester in the room giving feedback, what that's like, but what about when you're the only tester in the room and you happen to be a woman? So that's another challenge. So if I could just have all the women in the room stand up. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here. We would love to see you on Friday. It's a free day. It's a free day to get inspired about your career and software testing, and we would love to see you there. Also, just there is a larger proportion of women in testing than most areas of technology, and what we see is a smaller proportion of women applying to speak at these conferences. So one of the goals is to hear from more of you, to have you apply to speak at the conferences, and so we'd really love to hear from you. So come join us on Friday. Thank you.
It's going to be a great day. I encourage you to attend that. As a courtesy to our speakers, if you would silence your cell phones, do the appropriate thing there, we would we'd like that. Now, we have out in virtual land, hello virtual land, lots and lots of people who are attending this conference virtually. For one reason or another, they couldn't come physically, but we welcome them to the virtual conference. They're going to spend the day today and tomorrow with us. I know that time zones are interesting. You know, it's almost 5 p.m. in Europe right now. It's we have a big contingent in Vietnam, I know, watching, and it's past 10:30. It's almost 11 p.m. at night for them. And so we're glad to welcome you, virtual audience, and we applaud your staying up late or getting up early to join us. All right, it's my pleasure now to introduce our opening keynote speaker, and this is B.J. Rollison. Let me read the official bio for B.J. B.J. Rollison has more than 25 years of experience in the software industry. His 20-year career at Microsoft began in 1994 on Windows 95, and it ended several projects later on the Windows Phone team. At Microsoft, he held various individual and leadership positions, but he says the most rewarding was as the test architect in Microsoft's Engineering Excellence Group, where he designed and delivered hands-on training to over 6,000 testers. He now teaches software testing and test automation practices at the University of Washington and also at a university in Vietnam. He enjoys sailing, stamp collecting, gardening, and spending time with his family. BJ is an old friend of mine, and I'm thrilled to have him here today. Please welcome BJ Rollison.
Thanks, Lee. Yeah, I'll get it. I'm lazy, so I need a chair. really, I just want this to be informal, and thank you, Lee. I think it's really, I'm really honored to be here. I don't know if Lee remembers, but this was my first public conference that I did 11 years ago. And so it's very fitting with me retiring from the field, so to speak, other than teaching, to be back here. And I'm really honored to do that, to be here. And it's really great to see this many people here. I think when I spoke here before, it was probably about 500 or so. Certainly not this many, or actually not 500, about 200. The thing that I wanted to talk about today was not trying to give you some idea of what we do at Microsoft or what we did at Microsoft, although I'll use a lot of that as examples, because that's my experience, right? When you come to these conferences, when you hear a keynote, you hear any speaker, they're speaking about their experience, their story. And one of the things that I've learned over the years is that most of our businesses are pretty damn successful, but we have our own ways of doing things. When I first started speaking, it was an eye-opener for me, because I sort of assumed that everybody knew what, you know, when I was talking about unit testing, we were talking about automation, when we're running 25,000, 50,000 tests in 30 minutes. And for a lot of people, it sort of boggled their brain. The numbers were astounding. And that was back in 94, 95. So over the years, I learned a lot about different companies, also about different groups inside of Microsoft. Everybody thinks that, you know, you look at Microsoft and you go, oh, Microsoft, you know, they suck at testing, but at least everybody's doing the same thing, right? Which could not be further from the truth. Every team has its own test harness and its own test engine, trying to shoehorn everything into a common test framework across all the diverse product groups at Microsoft would be asinine. And it's the same thing that applies here. We have tools that we use in our different groups. You have different tools that you probably use in your groups that work for you. And so there's some tools that will easily transfer across and be helpful in your team if you have that problem to solve. But sometimes there's people offering solutions to problems that you don't have. And you have to be wary of those. So if you're not familiar, Testing Mentor, I had a website called Testing Mentor for a while and offered some tools and did blogging for a long time. And as Lee said, I started my career in the Windows team, working on international versions of Windows. And then IE, various other opportunities within the company. And I ended, before I left Microsoft, I wanted to go back to the product team. So I was working in our engineering excellence, which is sort of like a center of excellence, if you're familiar with that term. And we did the training for new engineers coming in, not just testers. All developers got the same training for their unit tests. We did acquisition training anytime we got new acquisitions. We also worked with the Chinese government to help establish some vendors and work with companies there. So I got to see a lot of the world. I got to visit with a lot of different companies. Before I left, I wanted to get back into the product group and see what real work was like again. So I went back and finished my tenure there in Windows Phone team. And it was pretty eye-opening. But when I went back to work, I stopped blogging, and I stopped speaking at conferences. And then I retired last year, and I went sailing, and as I'm sailing on my boat, and I thought, you know, a lot of that stuff that I blogged about, a lot of the debates that I would have with very smart and very knowledgeable people in the field really didn't amount to a hill of beans. It's interesting, but it didn't affect my career. There were some things that management just doesn't care about. And it's not impacting our career. It's not enhancing our career. It's not enhancing the software testing community as a whole. And so I'm going to give you my opinion on what I think those things are, or some of those things are. And at the end, I welcome your questions. The things that I'm going to talk about are probably somewhat controversial, I hope. Certifications, schools of testing, although schools of testing is just an idea. Standards, life cycles, exploratory testing, automation. I'm not going to go deep. Just going to say a few things because we could be here forever on that. Traditional roles. So what is the traditional role in testing management? And then hopefully a little bit about career and some career guide advice that both from an IC individual contributor and from being a director at Microsoft and hiring manager. So there's always debates on certifications. ISTQB, there's QAI, there's CSTE, there's numerous certifications within the industry. And there's always individuals who denounce or ridicule the certifications. I've known a lot of people that have gone through the certifications. I know some people that actually work on and teach those certifications, and I know a lot of people that haven't had it. In fact, certifications, I would say, in terms of Microsoft or Google, Amazon, certifications aren't even thought of. It's not even a thought in anyone's mind there. That doesn't mean that they can't be valuable or they aren't valuable to an individual. So it's the same way that I think about education as a whole. I've met a lot of people, and I've taught some people who go into class and they sit there and they don't work on projects, they don't study, they don't read, they have every excuse in the world, you know, their dog ate their homework or, you know, their computer crashed that morning, something like that. And those people are, you know, they're not going to succeed. They may, at the end of 4 years, have a degree that says that, yes, I have a degree in computer science. But I've interviewed countless people. I interviewed one individual, and I said, I want you to solve this problem for me. And he said, well, I haven't coded in a couple years. And I said, okay, well, you can use pseudocode. And he started, and he wrote about two lines, and he said, no, I really haven't done this. And I'm thinking, and he graduated 6 months prior. And so I'm thinking, you know, this individual may have the degree, may have a piece of paper that says, yeah, he went through school, but what did he really learn? And so I think it's the same thing with certifications. You know, as students, it's not just about going through and sitting through some lecture or some talk or some classes and thinking that you're going to learn things through osmosis, right? You have to think about, you have to look at different perspectives. You have to challenge the teacher and get different insights. That's how you learn. And so it's not about whether certifications are good or bad. It's if you want to have a certification, if you want a certification, if you want to learn more, maybe certifications are the right avenue. Maybe they're not. Some employers, I know many shops in Europe, for example, they look for certifications. Is it a good thing? I don't know. I do think that one of the things that I heard from a couple different managers is certifications teach all my testers to speak the same language. I don't have to explain regression testing. I don't have to explain equivalence class partitioning to them. So now they might have to explain how to do it and how to do it correctly, but they don't have to explain what the concept is. So the certification companies have a great marketing engine. And they do a great job at marketing, and they do a great job at marketing to company heads. the people that make decisions. What I've learned is it doesn't do any good for me as a blogger or even a conference speaker to stand up here and bitch about certifications unless I have an alternative, a viable alternative, to offer managers and decision makers. And that's, you know, I mean, so I don't get why we argue over it. If you're in Europe and the company that you're looking at wants you to get certified, get certified. But do it in a way that you don't sit there and say, I'm going to dismiss all of this. Go in and learn and challenge, and then also think of different aspects. Another thing that sometimes comes up is the schools of testing. Now, I did a blog on that. I didn't really care for the schools of testing. And if you're not familiar with the schools of testing, in 2007, Brett Petticord actually came up with these concepts of schools of testing, and he called them the analytic school, the quality school, the standard school, the agile school, and the context-driven school. And he had a really great presentation trying to outline the pros and cons, the philosophy of each of the different schools. The problem that I had with schools was that I didn't see a single school that was the complete solution to everything. Again, you have to think of, you have to look at each of those things in the context that you're in. You have to think about, what is the problem that I'm trying to solve? What am I trying to do here? And so, if you, rather than trying to segment the population of testers into different schools of thought, why don't we learn to say, okay, great, what's the best thing we can learn, or what's the best value we can gather from each of these schools? And then how do we drill that in? How do we learn those attributes and incorporate that in, rather than just trying to follow one ideology? It just doesn't make sense. So if you are familiar with the schools of testing, or if you investigate it, again, Brett Petticord did a great presentation, but when I read it, it's like, okay, I do a little bit of this, I do a little bit of this. Sometimes I'm heavy in this area, which is good, because if I know that I'm heavy in analytics, then I need somebody more in another school to help balance me out. And I look at that in the same way as I'm building my team. So don't get caught in thinking that there's one religion that you have to follow in testing, right? There's a lot of different ways, and we have a lot of problems to solve in order to really improve our profession. Standards. Just by a show of hands, how many of you, I'm sorry for the virtual audience, I can't see your hands. So how many of you work at a company where you adhere to ISO or ANSI standards? Okay. So are you building commercial software that's publicly available and adhering to ANSI standards? What is the software? Okay, so that's not publicly available. I mean, to the average consumer. Yeah, but bank. For the consumer. Okay, great. And I would say that banking industry, airline industry, there's certain industries that are regulated by the government, have to follow those standards. Right? There's a requirement, but those standards are also minimum standards, are they not? Yes, they are. And that's the problem. One of the problems that I sometimes see, or debated and wasted. I didn't waste my time. Maybe I did waste my time blogging about it. I don't think, because I was trying to express my frustration with it all. In the end, it was, did I really change anything? Maybe I made some people think differently. Maybe I pissed some people off. But did I change anything for my career? Not really. There was a couple quotes that I read, that one that said, standards were a direct threat to the style and approaches in the schools of thought of testing. Do you find that? I think, you know, again, if we look at standards and we only do the standards, I would say yes. But if you can think, if you have half a brain cell that's active and it's banging around in your brain, then intuition says that I'm probably going to do a little bit more here. I don't feel comfortable with just doing this rigid, confined set of minimum requirements. I need to do more for my customer. I need to do more for my product group and for the business. The same post that I read on this was that standards incentivize large testing organizations to reject non-certified testers and organizations. Again, I'm thinking large testing organizations, Microsoft, Google, Amazon. You know, these guys aren't anywhere near standards, right? I mean, we're talking, you know, 6,000, 5,000 testers each at each organization. So that's what I think of a large testing organization. And trust me, large organizations are not going anywhere near the whole standards debate. Now, I think Stuart Reed goes out on the conference circuit and he's talking about the ISO standards, especially this new one that they're putting together, I don't think he's trying to force it down everybody's throat. I think maybe he's looking for feedback. Maybe he's presenting some ideas or some guidelines that, hey, maybe that's a good idea in my group. So, again, as you sit through these talks, you're going to hear ideas. You're going to hear how people have solved problems with various solutions in their groups. It may or may not work for you, but sometimes you sit through a whole talk, and I've done this many times for the conferences. I sit through a talk, and I'm thinking, like, know that, okay, that's boring, okay, no, that's a bunch of crap. Hey, what he just said or she just said is really interesting. And it made me think. And then I'd do some research and I'd see if I could apply it. So that's how we have to open up and we have to think about our talks and about these different things of standards. You know, can we learn from them, not just reject them wholeheartedly? Because if you're in a commercial software space more than, and not in a regulated industry, games, you know, I really can't see, what's this? I'm not a game player. It boggles my brain if I'm watching television and I see a commercial for Candy Crunch. I never thought I'd, and my age perhaps, I never thought I'd see an iPhone game or a phone game advertised on TV. But, you know, I just don't see the developers of Candy Crunch developing or adopting ISO standards. Life cycles. So when we look at life cycles, and the life cycle of the day is agile, right? It's been around, actually not of the day, since, what, 2004 perhaps? Probably even before that concept. The way that I think of agile is that agile is just continual improvement. And so I have to say, in my experience, in the teams that I've worked in before Microsoft and at Microsoft and had contact with, I've never worked with a team that had a true waterfall life cycle. To me, it's sort of like this fictitious beast that it probably exists somewhere. I just never seen it. I'm sure there's some concept of it, of where all the development work is done in one place, and maybe there's a handoff to a separate testing team. I've just never seen that before. The life cycles that I've been used to have been continual life cycles. Even from in 1994, when I started Microsoft, and I was doing some work at IBM Japan prior to that, we were doing weekly builds. And so once a week, we would get a new build, and we would track the bug fixes going in, we would track new features going in, we would track new tests that were being applied to new features going in, we were tracking the tests that should be passing based on bug fixes. And you would come in on the, I was fortunate because I did the BVT, the build verification test suite, to make sure that the build is stable. And then I would send out mail and say, here's the problems that I found, here's what's working, here's what's not. And I had 30 minutes to make a decision of reject it and kick it back to development, which was a very expensive ordeal, or to send it out for test only, meaning it was a little bit unstable, but we could work through it, and still gain testing progress. Or the third option was what we called self-host. And so I would, in my office, I would typically have I had more machines, but the typical tester had three machines. One of their machines was their self-host machines. And that's the machine that we did the day-to-day grind on. We had our email, bug report, and it was all done on that machine. And then we had one to two machines for testing. And every week, those machines would get flashed with the latest build, latest test build. Every self-host build, your main machine had to get reflashed with the latest self-host. So not only, and so a lot of people call this dog fooding, but we call it self-hosting, where we're basically we have to eat our own stuff and actually work on it and use it from day to day. So not just testing it, but using it as we would normally use it in our day-to-day lives. And so throughout the product cycle, I saw, you know, every company is looking for continual improvement. After a product ships, or actually, we would then break our product cycle down into what we called milestones or iterations in the agile terminology. And at the end of every iteration, we would have a retrospective. We called them postmortems. And we would look and say, what's wrong? What do we need to change? And at the end of every product, we would have a postmortem or a retrospective to say, what do we need to change? And the important thing there is that when you do that, you have somebody who's responsible, you give them a timeline, and management has to keep them responsible to that doing that thing. If somebody slips on what their responsibility is, nothing's going to change. And trust me, I've seen a lot of times where you go through a retrospective, where teams have gone through a retrospective or gone through a postmortem. These are the problems. They fill out paper, you know, whiteboards, and they fill out flip charts of here's the thing, here's the things that I want to bitch about today. And they write it all out, have a little few beers, and then everybody feels good and goes home. Next day you come in, and the same shit happens again. And that's a failure of management, right? It's really a failure of management. It's a failure of us, because if I don't leave that meeting and go, wait, this is great stuff, but who's going to do it? And when can I have it done? Otherwise, why should I come in tomorrow? Because if I come in tomorrow and nobody's going to do anything, I'm just going to have the same headache next week. So when I think of life cycles, regardless of the life cycle, whatever we call it, I think it's all about continuous improvement and how you break it down and which book you want to follow, which processes you want to follow. It's whatever processes help you improve product after product. Because that's when you may have small incremental improvements during the life cycle, but it's really, you know, when you're jumping from product from one release to the next release where you can really start to make significant changes. And now I'll talk about exploratory testing. I was asked this question prior to the conference, and it went out on the website. And I have a hard time with exploratory testing because I think it's all testing is exploratory testing in nature. I would even go as far as saying my baseline regression tests are exploratory. Because now I'm getting daily builds. There's a lot of code going in daily. And when I was on the phone team, I need to flash my phone every day. And so there's a lot of changes going in. And so even my baseline test, my unit test and my regression test suite, is giving me information. It's saying, here's the changes that happen, and is there any variation between build n minus 1 and build n? And so is it doing exploratory testing in the sense of I'm sitting down and designing my test in real time? No, it's not. But is that test still providing me information? Yeah. Now, in terms of providing me more information and doing my testing in real time, I think that's really the bread and butter of testing. And I'll talk about automation in a minute, but you know, automation is very valuable to me, but one of the things that we found, and maybe I'll couple automation right now, is that I was a big automation pundit, and I still am. I think automation is great. I don't think it's the holy grail, and I think when used wisely, it's really valuable. And I think it's really valuable because automation frees up my time. And being a lazy guy, I want to do things that the machine can't do or doesn't do very well. Or to experiment, right? Automation's not really good at experimentation. And so one of the things that, and when we use test, when we do testing, whether we call it exploratory testing or testing, you have to think about what am I really doing? It's my automation solves a problem. It does a lot of things for me. It gives me a lot of information in a really small amount of time. But what I need me and testers, whether it's a tester, again at Microsoft, everybody had to flash their phones. For example, when I worked in the phone team, everybody flashed their phones every day. PMs, testers, developers flashed every single day. We had multiple phones. So, and then we had to use that phone. We carried that phone that we flashed every day throughout our day. That's the phone that we communicated on, we texted on, we sent emails, we played Candy Crunch on. So, you know, and that gives us a lot, not just the usage, but also we tested on those devices. And so that's where you find a lot of the things that testers should be doing. We're evaluating the capabilities of that software, and we're exposing potential flaws. And that's where exploratory testing, testing in general, comes in, where I add a lot of value to the process. Because it's going to be me, the tester, who finds flaws that our customers are going to care about, usability flaws especially. There's functional flaws my automation can find. There's some functional flaws that my automation probably can't find. In fact, I was sitting by the pool the other day. I was going through my messages, deleting the ones that were crap, and then adding contact information to the messages that I wanted to, that I wanted to have contact for. Started adding a name. I got a phone call. Answered the phone call. Finished the phone call. Went back to the contact card. Finished putting it out. Pushed done. That took me back to that individual's message. And I pushed cancel, done, and it took me back to the contact card. And so now I'm stuck in a continuous loop between contact card and contact message. That's on an iPhone. Now, there's no way I could not automate that. So there's little things like that irritate our customers that through usage, through normal usage, and through what if I do this, right? Not, you know, this isn't like, the testing labs that get to drop bricks. We didn't get to drop bricks on phones, right? Because we're not building the hardware devices themselves. But, you know, I'm not worried about what if I drop a brick on it, but what if I do this instead of doing this? That's where we become really creative and where we can really sit back after we think about all the functional automation we can write, where we can sit back and go, okay, now how do I become valuable, more valuable to the system? Which brings us to automation. I'm pro automation. I think it's a good thing. But I think it's a good thing if you can control it, because it can become a really crazy beast. Where I found automation to be very valuable is when you're dealing with large amounts of data, when you have huge data variability, when you're looking at permutations, combinations, things like that, stress, performance, concurrency, load, when you have situations that, you know, you really can't do it, man. It's not convenient to do it manually, right? Your baseline tests, unit tests, regression tests are extremely valuable. I do think that perhaps the most, should I say this politically correct, or should I just say it? The biggest bunch of crap tests I ever seen are UI tests. Especially UI tests where I sit down and pretend to be a user and script out the steps. Launch application, push button X, enter Bob in in name, enter password in password, push OK. What a brain dead test that is. And in fact, in many cases, and I've seen, you know, and I've read the debates, and I read that, you know, a lot of times, and I have to clarify automation too. When I talk about automation, I'm talking about automation that does what I want it to do and then checks to make sure that it did what it's supposed to do. And if I need it to, also checks any other machine state that I possibly think could have went wonky. So if I'm interested in losing memory, for example, then I'd certainly tap into kernel APIs and take memory snapshots before and after. What I see a lot of automation doing is not what I would think of automation. To me, and I'm an old guy, do you remember, what is it, what was on Windows? Windows Recorder, right? What did Windows Recorder do for you? It automated a set of steps. We used to call those macros. It was really cool. I could get Windows Recorder or Apple Automator to set up, follow a set of steps over and over that I wanted it to do. But that's not automation. That's a macro. So when I think of automation, I'm really thinking, you know, start to finish. Does it tell me something valuable? Not do I have to go in and do it, do something else. Now, if my automation fails, whether it's a code failure, whether it's saying you have a bug, or whether it fails during runtime, now I have to go in and investigate. And my automation should be extremely verbose to tell, at least give me a point of failure to start from. But I've seen a lot of problems with automation, and as I said, When I first started, my manager told me I had 30 minutes to do the BBT on the Japanese, Korean, Taiwan, and simplified and Chinese and traditional versions of Chinese. And I said, 30 minutes, that's impossible. Right? Even though I had plenty of machines to do, 30 minutes was not enough for an OS. That's what I'm thinking. He says, you got 30 minutes. And so I had to be really crisp about what went into that regression suite. So we called that the BVT, which is just a part of the first part of the regression suite. Later, at that time, Microsoft had divided consumer Windows and enterprise Windows. We were two separate teams. After 95 and 98, Windows was combined, and the enterprise team took it over. About a year after the enterprise team took over the Windows product line, their BVT took 23 hours. Every failure that they found, this is the crazy part. Every bug that they found, they automated a test to make sure that bug didn't happen again. And it went into the BVT, not into the regression suite, went into the BVT. And it took a day. And so now, if you're a tester, if you're a poor tester, you come in the morning and you're testing away, you find a bug, you write the bug up, the developer comes in, and the developer says what to you? Did you test it on the latest build? Well, no, because the latest build's not coming out until 11:30 tonight. Okay, well, see if you can reproduce the bug tomorrow. So it's like you should it's like just take every other day off, right? But it was craziness, right? And so that's when, testers started complaining and say, look, we're wasting all this time. And somebody with half a brain cell went in and said, look, you got an hour to run this test, to make this decision. And so when you're thinking about your automation, you have to really control that beast or it's going to get out of hand. And you have to subdivide it into different suites. What's important? What's not important? Do I have to run these tests every day on every new build? Or do I have to run them at the BBT? Or can I run them during the day? Or use machine cycles at night? And that's what we did. One of the things that we had lots and lots of tests is that one of the things that we finally hooked up is we finally got lots of money to build huge labs, labs with 5,000 computers. And then that wasn't even enough. And so what we started doing was hijacking machines. You go home at night, we'd find a machine in your office that's sitting idle for 30 minutes, it's on our domain, we're running tests. Thank you very much. Sometimes people wouldn't be real happy in the morning. No, there weren't that many failures, some. But there's other things that you have to think about with automation as well, and that is you need somebody in charge of that animal. Everybody can't be just mucking around in the pond, especially when you're dealing with, if you have frameworks. When I went to the Windows Phone team, part of my responsibility, actually my total responsibility, was to get their automation under control. I went into one framework for one feature, and I found one method with 18 variations in three different classes. It was crazy. And it was because, I need to add this parameter. Or in some cases, they didn't even add parameters. They took parameters away and hard-coded the variables. Bob password. Shit, I know Bob password works on every Windows phone. And so you need somebody to control that because what happens? We all think we're smarter than the person who wrote the original method. Or that method's good, but it won't work on my team. And so rather than talking about it and making it work or figuring out a solution, we just throw in more code and more crap code into the pile, which bloats it. And then you have, so that's the framework piece that gets out of hand. And then you also have the tests that get out of hand as well. One of the tests that I came across was logging on to the Windows phone and then going to the Me card, what we call the Me card, and sending, and from the Me card I could send out a tweet. Does anybody have a Windows phone? Great, you know what I'm talking about then. Everybody else just pretend. Because I don't have a Windows phone anymore. sorry, Microsoft, but I'm a total Mac guy now. So from the Me card, I could send out a tweet. And so I found this test where the tester wrote a test to send out the login and send out a one-character tweet. So I'm looking at this and I'm thinking like, okay, what would possess first? What in the hell would possess a person to write this test to begin with? I'm thinking like, are they thinking it's a boundary test? Okay, maybe, let's go with that. They're thinking it's a boundary test, which is a really horrible test to put into any sort of regression suite at all. But, that's boundary tests are something that if I automated them, not at the unit level, which is where they should be, is something that I would maybe automate and run once a product cycle. But anyway, so I found this, it's a one-character tweet, and after it gets checked in into the line, it's failing all over the place. And that's how I found it, actually. It was because it's failing. It's passing on one, but it's failing on the others. And they didn't understand why it's failing on the others. And so I'm thinking like, okay, well, let's look at the test. Well, they're logging in, Bob password. Tweet A. And so we have our new build on today, but we have 13 branches. So all 13 branches are being built every day. And so once one branch runs, on the remaining 12, the test is failing. Because Bob password, can only send the same tweet once every 24 hours. So although this person didn't really understand the whole concept of tweeting, perhaps, and then they're doing a boundary test, which is even driving me more insane, they didn't even try or didn't even think about randomizing the damn character that they were sending. So what do I know? I know Bob password can log in and you can send, and if you're Bob password, you can send a one character tweet of A. What a worthless damn test. So you have to think about your automation. And be creative. You can be creative with automation. So as we were getting in that last product cycle I was working on, we wanted to include IMAP search on Windows Phone. Didn't have IMAP search prior to that. And so they ran out of testing bodies, so I said, okay, I'll write the test for that. Got the API spec, started writing my tests. Now, of course, I'm thinking, okay, what kind of, I'm searching on IMAP mail, and IMAP clients are around the world, so I'm thinking, great, Unicode string. I'm gonna randomize the hell out of Unicode string and pump it into my search engine. Developer gets done, writes his unit tests pass with flying colors, gives me a private build, fails all over the place. Why did it fail? Because I had mail with Thai characters, I had mail with Japanese, I had mail virtually every language we had, and we were doing 39 languages. And when it tried to search on Thai in particular, it failed every single time. When it tried to search on Indic characters, it failed every single time. Because the developer, now, and this is what, this boggled my brain at the time, because he was a reasonably young developer, had been there a year. All of Microsoft Codebase had been Unicode enabled since Windows 95. I'm thinking like, okay, we live in a Unicode world. No, this asshole was thunking back to ANSI. I'm thinking like, you're thunking, why? What would possess you to thunk back to ANSI for a search? Well, Yahoo and AOL are ANSI. Who the hell uses AOL? I didn't even know AOL was still viable. No, I'm kidding. Sorry, AOL users. But now, it wasn't clearly spelled out, but there's assumptions. Sometimes we make these assumptions in the specs and things like that. We assume that everything's Unicode. But this is a way that you can be creative with your tests and your automation. You can use randomization if you control it with the seed value, if it's repeatable, right? You can expand your automation. If you're doing a test and you're looking for timing, you can include stopwatches. If you're looking for mem leaks, you can call kernel APIs to look for those things, right? You can be creative with automation. It should not be launch, fill in Bob, fill in password, press OK, wait for screen. That's sort of brain dead automation. And anybody should be embarrassed to even have that in your test suite. I could talk about automation forever. I've seen a lot of crap. But I also have seen a lot of good stuff too. There's a lot of good automation out there too that gives us a lot of value. But again, you know, everybody's business is a little bit different. And you have to figure out what works for your business. Testing roles was something I was asked about again. And there's this, who's in a traditional testing role? Does anybody know what a traditional testing role is? I said, I don't know what the hell a traditional testing role is, because to me, when I talk to people that think that they're in a traditional testing role, they talk about a traditional testing role, I'm thinking like, that's not my tradition. When I started at Microsoft, testers and developers went through the same interview loop. And it wasn't until later that we started getting away from asking testers coding questions. And so is the traditional role my experience, or is it someone's experience from 1998 or 99, 2000. I don't know. I don't really put a lot of stock in thinking about traditional testing roles. What I think is that what is my role? And how is my role viable today and next week and next year? I don't care about the past so much. I can learn from the past. I can't change the past. What I need to do is I need to think about what is going to make me a viable employee or a value asset to my company. I know we don't like to think that we're assets to companies because we're human beings, blah, blah, blah. Guess what? Your company can fire you anytime. You're an asset. You're there to do good. You're there to help them make money. And if you do a great job and they make more money, then maybe you get a bonus. Maybe your salary goes up. You have to be, and it's not just about thinking about today, right? You have to look out. When I first started talking at conferences, I was looking at what was happening, what was the trend at Microsoft. And already by that time, we knew after the bubble bust in 2000, it was not a free-for-all. Companies weren't hiring plethoras of testers anymore to beat the shit out of products to find bugs.
companies were saying, look, we're hiring a lot of people. We're hiring, getting the butcher, the baker, and the candlestick maker. And they're finding bugs, but can we do this smarter? Can we do it cheaper? And then they started talking about the evil automation stuff again. And eventually, testers who were good bug finders, very good at their craft of finding bugs, but limited out. They failed to grow their skills. And they were the first on the chopping block. And it's hard. As a manager, you guys know, if you're managers, even your suckiest employees, it's hard to fire. It's hard to fire even your suckiest employees. I even had, as a manager, I had to walk people, I didn't walk them out. I had to be in a room when employees were handcuffed. I mean, I checked out for the next 2 days as a manager. He broke the law. But, you know, as a manager, that sort of sucks. So you have to think about, you know, from a skills perspective and a role perspective, how do I grow my skills? How do I add value? When I started speaking, I was talking about some studies that we had done inside where we knew these changes were coming. We knew we were driving back towards testers with technical skills, with coding skills. And that's what I talked about. I tried to give some examples, and Lee helped me hone that presentation a little bit. And I was ridiculed and said, oh no, testers should never have to know how to code, and if they code, it's just going to pollute your mind because we really can't think about coding and finding bugs in the same brain, right? Those two brain cells can't coexist. And you all know that's horseshit. So, but I was ridiculed. I was ridiculed by people, and it wasn't later, and by consultants, you know, the people that within this group, and later, I think people came to consensus and said, maybe this coding thing might be a good thing, and I think it is, because the more we understand about the thing we're actually working on and trying to provide value for, to make sure that it's viable, and find potential flaws. The more we understand it, the more insights and the different ways we can explore it. Right? You don't go mountain climbing if you have never had a carabiner on before, or if you don't know how to rappel. You just don't do it. Same thing with caving, spelunking. So I already talked a little bit about management. It's hard being a manager. It's not fun sometimes. Sometimes it's fun. You get to tell people what to do. You get to make shit up. Managers suck, don't they? Some of them. But because we all hear, you know, it's the Peter principle, right? It's all our managers look like that manager from the Dilbert cartoon, right? I'm just missing the things over here. So, I think good managers are hard to come by. I've worked for some bad managers. I've worked for some great managers. My first manager at Microsoft told me, he said, at Microsoft, you can basically carve your own way. You can go as high as you want. And I found it to be pretty true. Now, there's a cap, and there's always caps, right? I mean, if you don't play nicely with others and you say that Microsoft products suck, then you're not going to be a VP, right? But the thing I want to say about managers is they're really not as dumb as we think. Most managers aren't stupid. I mean, they're there. And what I found in my experience is the really bad managers, as especially if you have multiple teams. Now, if you're in a shop that, you know, you don't have multiple managers or you don't have multiple teams, it's hard. You can get stuck with that Peter principal manager, somebody who's been there. He's the nephew of the, you know, grandfather of the sister who's in HR. And so, you know, the thing that you have to do is you have to think of, Lee's going to kick me off, but you have to believe that for most managers, they're there because they know about business, and they're trying to make the business better. Now, sometimes that might jive with your way of implementing something, but most managers are pretty successful at their jobs. And so we should probably give them a little bit of credit. The bad ones I've seen where teams would then bypass their manager and go to another manager for advice. And those are weeded out pretty quickly. Okay. I'm not going to talk about career then. So I'll wrap it up with, you know, throughout this conference, I would say, you know, there's a lot of information. There's a lot of tools that you're going to see available. Don't look for problems, or don't seek out solutions, or don't find solutions looking for problems, and don't manufacture those problems. When you go to talks and you go to these different talks throughout the day today and tomorrow, think about, you know, open your mind a little bit and say, you know, maybe I know a little bit about this, or maybe I don't know a little bit about this, or this, that's not how we do it, but listen to what they're saying. Listen, what was their problem? How did they solve that problem? Do I have that problem? Or even if I don't have the problem, is there something, is there one thing I can take away with that that adds value to me? And that's the greatest thing I've gotten from every conference that I attended, every speech I attended and listened to. I always would jot down one thing that impacted me that I would think about long term. Well, I think I'm out of time. Yep, I'm out of time. So I really appreciate your time, and I hope you have a wonderful conference experience. Thank you.
You know, there's a phrase that comes to mind as I hear BJ talk, and that's the gentle voice of reason. I really appreciate what he's shared with us today. He's got a lot of experience, and he's, like many of us, have, you know, bumped down the hill and had some of the sharp things knocked off. And I really appreciate his kind of centrist, middle-of-the-road, context-sensitive approach to things. We have about a quick 10-minute break before we bring on Paul Gerard, who's our second keynote speaker. So you get to stand up for a second. Restrooms are nearby. We'll start again at 10. Thank you.
That wraps up this event. Thank you for joining us. Please check the Presentation Center for other presenters and their start times. And don't forget to join us for live interviews between presentations.